Coming up on this episode of Disneyland Weekly, a preview of Pixar Fest, annual passholder exclusives.
More monorail wraps, 9,500 feet of rockwork and pirates, and more. Disneyland Weekly starts now.
This is Disneyland Weekly.
Hello and welcome to this episode of Disneyland Weekly for the week of April 11th, 2018. I'm Teg Bushman.
And I'm Teresa Urban. This week we would like to thank Tim for becoming a patron at the Park Hopper level, Brandon for joining at the cast member level. Brandon's actually been pretty active in our chat, plus he was actually in Disneyland this weekend. And finally, Anthony joining at the general admission level. We thank all of you for helping to support the show.
We're taking a survey of our listeners, and we'd like you to participate. It will help us learn more about you, no matter how long you've been a listener or how frequently you listen to the show. So please take a few minutes and visit our website at disneylandweekly.com/survey. Thank you to all who have already completed the survey. We're happy seeing all the feedback. Thank you.
Now let's get to the news. In the parks this Thursday, April 12th, then you are in for a treat. Not only is it the last day of the Food and Wine Festival, but it is also a preview night for Pixar Fest at the resort. Starting at 5 p.m., you can see the Pixar Play Parade in Disneyland. Then at 8:15, if you are in California Adventure, you can catch the Paint the Night Parade. Finally, at 9:15, Together Forever, a Pixar Nighttime Spectacular, will light up the skies above Disneyland. All of these will begin daily performances on Friday, but if you can't wait an extra day, this is the perfect opportunity.
How do you feel about...
We were talking about this before the show. So as some of you may remember, this is exactly the week that I thought was like the prime time to go and visit the park. And so I was really pushing that maybe Tag and I could be there for this week, but we're not. So the fact that there's like extra amazing, fun things going on this week, just kind of... Ugh. But I'm so happy because we have several of our listeners are actually going and are actually... in the parks right now. So I'm really excited for them that they get to experience all this extra magic that unfortunately Tag and I are not experienced, but that's okay.
Even though you can't experience it.
Even though I can't.
Even though that would
okay.
be the perfect day for you because it's all of the things.
Yeah, everything. All the things.
Well, with the beginning of Pixar Fest, if you're an annual pass holder, there'll be some extras that you can take advantage of. There will be an annual pass holder corner in Paradise Pier where you can stop in for a free collectible, take pictures at photo spots, and pick up some pass holder exclusive merchandise. The theme for this area will change every 2 weeks with new free items and photo spots. The dates for these themes are April 13th, April 27th, May 11th, and May 25th. Exclusive merchandise includes pins, t-shirts, drinkware, and more.
I think this is such a great idea that they're doing with this. Just, you know, another extra perk to become an annual pass holder. But the fact that they're trying to pull you back into the parks multiple times. And that's, I mean, just think of how much different stuff that they had to purchase for all of these free giveaways. The fact that it's, because usually stuff like this, it's just one item and it's, you know, right. until you run out kind of a deal. So I think that's really cool that they're switching it up.
Yeah, I like that they're doing it every couple weeks too. So you, even if you're an annual pass holder, like you don't have to be there every single day. You can go every couple days. Mm-hmm. And I think that's great. Or not every couple weeks. And I think that would be great. Mm-hmm. So it's exciting that they're giving a lot of stuff to annual pass holders. Obviously, a lot of people are annual pass holders. So anyway.
Another perk for the annual pass holders will be a premium popcorn bucket that will provide you with dollar refills through June 21st. The bucket itself is $20, and you can purchase it from April 24th through May 24th while supplies last. So we will probably have a link with our show notes on this, but I was really excited to see that the popcorn bucket itself is actually, it is Pixar themed. It's from Toy Story. It's one of your favorite lovable little green aliens.
Ooh.
Ooh, the claw. So yeah, I thought it's a really neat looking popcorn bucket. It comes with a nice lanyard that actually has the AP logo on it. It's really nicely done. I think a lot of people who aren't annual pass holders are going to be pretty jealous that they can't go and purchase this popcorn bucket themselves.
Yeah, it's, you know, it's going to be another one of those items I think they're going to sell out and people are going to love, just like the Oogie Boogie popcorn bucket and everything else. So,
well, and come on, $1 refills, you can't beat that with prices. You know, some of the prices of foods and snacks in the park, that's great that it's a buck.
Yeah, you know what? And that's cheaper than what I get. So with the movie theater here locally, yeah. I paid, I don't remember how much, $25, I think, for the bucket. And every time I go, it's $4 refills.
Yeah.
So $1 refill, I mean, that's a great deal at Disney. So that's awesome. So one thing that will not be launching with Pixar Fest is the new float based on The Incredibles. The new edition will be delayed until sometime in June. I was actually surprised to read this when I was figuring out the script this week, because I thought that the new float was going to launch with the parade.
That was my understanding too, so I wonder if perhaps they had some sort of technical difficulties or didn't get the float put together in time, but that's okay. It's one more thing to look forward to.
Sure. Yeah, stretch it out a little bit more.
There you go.
What will be debuting on Thursday is new floats for the Pixar Play Parade, which Mice Age posted in their update this week, if you want to see the new floats before they premiere. So these are actually just concept drawings of the floats. I think they might have posted these a while ago, and Disney might have shown them a while ago, but I don't remember seeing them, yeah. So that's why I posted them before.
Oh, no, yeah, I'd seen them somewhere before. Where I saw them, I don't remember. We look at so much Disneyland information every week, which is great, but I sometimes it kind of gets mixed over as to where I saw what when we're, yeah. So anyways, but yeah, they looked familiar to me, and maybe just because I just really like these new designs, so that's maybe why they really stuck out in my head.
What do you think about this way that Disney's been doing it lately, where instead of coming up with a whole new parade, they like switch out parts of an existing parade? Do you like that, or would you rather them hold on to a parade longer?
I'm kind of okay with that, because there are, I mean, these floats are just, I feel like they can be more just more amazing and just bigger and better if they know it's going to be around longer versus something that's more temporary. So I feel like the quality of the things that they're coming out with for these are going to be much, much better.
Now, I don't know, for me, I don't know about the Pixar Play Parade. It's a fun parade. A lot of people like it. Don't have a problem with that. It's not particularly for me. I saw it a couple times. I thought it was fine. It wasn't anything over the top. However, Paint the Night, I think, is gorgeous. Paint the Night is this generation's electrical parade, and I think it's going to hang on for a long time. And I think the idea that they are changing and adding stuff and taking out stuff as time goes on, I would much rather them keep the Paint the Night parade for years and years and years, and it's great that they keep refreshing with it. That's my opinion on it.
As we reported previously, the monorails are getting wrapped up in Pixar characters for Pixar Fest. We noted that the orange monorail had the Incredibles designs, but this week, Monorail Blue got the Finding Nemo wrap, and the Monorail Red should be getting a Toy Story wrap soon. So they have actually posted some photos. We're going to, again, link this on our show notes. It looks like Mice Chat is where we got these from, but I really like the Finding Nemo wraps, too. I think they're just really, really well done.
Yeah, I mean, the ones we've seen have looked great. I'm really excited to see the Toy Story ones. In fact, I have a plan this week sometime to sit down and actually watch Toy Story again, because I haven't seen it in such a long time, and I'm excited to see it. So, you know, to celebrate Pixar Fest when we can't be at the park.
Celebrating from Wisconsin.
Of course. In the Opera House on Main Street, there's a new exhibition on Disney's environmentality in the form of an art show. On display are works of art made from recycled materials by Disneyland cast members. You can even vote for your favorite piece, and the winners get apparel made from recycled contents from Coke. So I think what this means is that they have, like, recycled stuff, like the clothing is made out of recycled things,
sure.
And it's paid for and provided by Coca-Cola. I don't know, I thought this was interesting. I saw this on Mice Chat. And I thought it was interesting that they have cast members using basically garbage or stuff that you can recycle and turn into something artistic. There's some really cool stuff in there. They're
gorgeous.
Yeah.
Really beautiful. Again, we will have this linked to the show notes, but I highly, highly, highly recommend for you guys to check these out. They are just awesome and just stunning. I mean, there's one that's it looks kind of like a stained glass Beauty and the Beast scene. That, I mean, I'm looking at these things that I wouldn't even told you that this was made from recycled materials or, you know, somebody's junk or garbage. But they're just very, very creative, very, very well done. Again, most of them I would not have known came from, you know, something that was just going to be tossed aside. Lots of things I do like, there's a lot of things with what am I trying to say? Wine corks, lots of wine cork things. But I think my favorite, just because it made me actually giggle out loud, is the trash compactor scene from Star Wars is one of the pieces in here. So I thought that was creative since they're making it out of junk, and well, they made a junk scene. So that, good on you for that one.
Does this inspire you at all to use some recyclable materials at your house and try to make something fun like this? Well, I know, see, you're a wine, you know, fan.
I'm creative in some aspects, but this kind of thing, I couldn't do this. I wish I could, but I couldn't. We do a lot of things around the house to be more eco-friendly, more environmentally friendly, lots of recycling, lots of reduced use of things so that we don't create more waste. But man, these people, they are
beyond creative,
in my opinion. Yeah, that's awesome. Some of these pieces, just looking at them, there's a Moana piece, and I'm just trying to figure out the time involved in these types of things. It's just mind-boggling to me. So I wish I could see these in person, because they're probably even more epic in person.
If you go see these in person, send us some pictures on Twitter, Facebook, email us.
Please. Tired of standing in lines to ride attractions only to have to stand in line to get food? Well, you may not have to wait for much longer. Mobile ordering is coming to the Disneyland app, where you can order your food and beverages at participating locations around the resort, pay, and then just walk up to the pickup window and grab your food and eat, all without waiting in line.
I did not use this at Disney World when I was there. I think they did have it at a couple places, but this just sounds awesome. Not having to wait in line, like, so I do that right here in town. So we got to do Taco Bell up the street, and they do mobile ordering. And it's so nice, especially if you have like a custom order. So those of you with kids who sometimes are picky eaters.
Or if you have, say, allergies.
Yeah, you can put it in the app. You don't have to like worry about, you know, if it's loud or busy or people in a rush and they don't get your order punched in the computer right. You just do it all on the app. And then you just go to the pickup window, you show them your thing, it's all paid for, done.
Well, the other nice thing, too, is say if you or someone you're with has some sort of food allergies, being able to like really study the menu from your phone and not feel maybe like you're holding up the line because you're trying to make sure what's in each dish and if it's going to be okay for your diet. You know, that's huge. Plus, I mean, sometimes reading those things and trying to read the little tiny fine print to see what all of the ingredients are, that's not fun either. So I can see how this would be helpful for a lot of different people.
Well,
of different reasons.
How about this one? So I've been there with people who we all can't decide on where we want to eat.
Sure.
What if everybody ordered what they wanted through their apps and they went and got them, and then you could all eat together at one central location?
That sounds great.
Because everybody could just run off and grab their food. They're not going to be stuck. One person's not going to be eating at a restaurant that's got a long line that's going to take half an hour while somebody else already has their food and it's getting cold. Mm-hmm. If everybody could just walk up to the window, grab their food, I think it's a great idea. Well, if you wanted to meet more Marvel characters at the resort, then this news will make your day. Doctor Strange will be added as a photo opportunity in Disney California Adventure in the coming weeks. The Disney Parks blog did not give a specific date for the meet and greet. I think that they're adding more and more Marvel stuff. Obviously, we know Marvel Land is coming at some point.
Trying to get the hype up, probably.
Yeah, too. Trying to get the hype up. And, they got to keep it fresh because they've had Captain America there for quite a while. They've had Spider-Man there quite a while. Mm-hmm. So it's good that they're going to put somebody else
there. The Guardians have been there.
Yeah.
Even you can do Brandon, actually, our new patron, sent us a photo. What are those photos called? Magic?
Like made with magic or something?
Yeah, those made with magic photos, and they were holding Baby Groot. It was awesome.
Yeah.
Obviously, they didn't see Baby Groot, but, I mean, still, the fact that they're doing all these extra things that are Marvel-related to get you pumped is just great.
It is great.
Mice Age posted concept art of the new Lamplighter Lounge coming to Disney California Adventure later this year. The new concept art shows a boardwalk-themed restaurant with extended canopy over the outdoor patio, which will allow it to remain open for seating when there is rain, unlike the previous outdoor seating. The Cove Bar area will get a more permanent roof as well.
Yeah, this concept art looks pretty cool. It looks like they're going to get rid of some of the carpet that's in there and go with some hardwood. They're going to put a lot of Pixar-inspired kind of designs on the wall and on the rugs that they're going to have in there and on the chairs and whatnot. So I think this looks good. I think it's going to be kind of more of an upscale kind of thing. you know, I've never actually eaten or even been in this building ever.
Sure.
And I'm kind of excited to go there. I don't know why I've never, because when it was Ariel's Grotto, I think there was always a line. And then when last time I went there, there was no Cove Bar. Well, Mouse Planet reports that Disneyland has filed for a permit to install new ceiling rock work inside of Pirates of the Caribbean when it goes down for refurbishment later this month. So this puts to rest the rumors that the only change coming to the attraction is the new auction scene. What is amazing is the amount of square footage of this work, 9,500 feet worth. That is a lot of rock
work.
That's
just crazy. I was trying to wrap my mind around this when we were going through the news earlier, and... You know, the other thing I never realized either, because I guess I'm just too focused on all of the scenes and all of the action going on around me in the attraction, that I never paid attention to the ceiling before. And, I mean, really, what is up there right now? Isn't it just painted black?
Well, it depends on where they're doing the work, and that's what I was trying to think about, too. Because when you first get on and you're going through the bayou by the blue bayou, it's just black. It's
right.
Painted black because it's outside.
Yep.
And then when you go down the drop, you're in a cave, so it's rock work, until you come out with the pirate battle, where it's attacking the fort, and then
that's
it's black again, and it's black throughout the entire rest of the attraction.
So I wonder if the areas, minus the bayou, so the area once you go down into, where the pirate battle is, after the caves, I wonder if that's where the rock work is going to be.
That doesn't
done.
Make sense, though, because you'd want to have, like...
Oh, yeah, because you're technically outside.
So I'm wondering
outside,
if they have to redo it. I wonder if there's, like, some rot or something
maybe.
That they have to replace.
Maybe.
Or maybe they just want it to look cooler.
It could just be freshened up.
Or add some more effects.
Maybe. Ooh, can't wait to find out.
Well, there might be another Pirates movie coming out, so maybe they're doing something with that.
Who knows? When the EMC closes down in downtown Disney, it will be relocating to the Anaheim Garden Walk. The new location is scheduled to open early 2019.
Well, you know, we talked about it before. Garden Walk needs something, and hopefully this will give it a little something. I wonder if a lot of those establishments that were in downtown Disney will move over to Garden Walk.
I don't think that'd be a bad idea. It would make sense. Unless, I don't know, maybe those businesses, were they doing that well? Weren't they doing well? I don't know.
I don't know either. Well, Laughing Place has also posted pictures this week of construction notice signs around the downtown Disney area in preparation for construction to begin on the new hotel complex, which includes the new parking structure.
Ooh, I am so excited to see what this is going to look like. I just think the concept drawings that we saw, like the very early concept drawings that we saw, just...
Yeah, I don't know how they're going to get it. I mean, it's got to start in June, because that's when, at the end of June, everybody's got to get out.
Yep.
So... I think Disneyland is going to start looking a lot like a lot of the property around Walt Disney World right now, which is there's going to be so much construction going on for the next year, because from whenever they start this project to when Galaxy's Edge opens, there's all that construction going on at Galaxy's Edge. There's going to be all this construction going on for the new hotel and parking ramp. There's already that going on. Marvel Land, they're going to start doing stuff with Bugs Land. So you're going to have construction everywhere.
Everywhere. You're going to have, construction in the park, construction out of the park. Plus, I feel like they're doing a lot of... It seems to me like they're doing a lot of updates and a lot of refurbs and a lot of just fixing things around just the regular resort and in the parks in preparation for Galaxy's Edge. Just stuff like, like the Pirates thing, you know, do they have to put in the new ceiling now? I mean.
Right. Well, I'll tell you something I didn't put in the news, but I did read about. And they've been, you know, we've talked about this before. They did all that stuff around It's a Small World. Mm-hmm. They're reworking the queue there. They're reworking the Dumbo queue. They're trying to clean up stuff. Something we didn't talk about was they took out a lot of planters in Fantasyland to make more room for people to walk around.
Yeah, they just need more walking space, more total space for the crowds that they're expecting to be coming through.
Now, how do you feel about that? Like, part of me, so like taking out the planters and stuff, part of me is like, okay, it's needed and I'd rather be able to get around the park. But part of me is like, you're taking away part of the atmosphere, so it kind of sucks.
No, I'm the same with you. I see both sides of it. I wish that they could keep it all there and keep that feeling and keep the greenery around in Fantasyland, but I understand why it has to go.
Now, the other thing I was thinking about, too, was a lot of times people make changes. Like, for instance, a couple years ago, I think 4 or 5 years ago at this point, when they redid Club 33 in New Orleans Square, there was a lot of people online that were very upset with how that like turned out. And I'll be honest with you, the last time I went, I couldn't even tell what was different. Like, And most people aren't going to. So I'm wondering, like, next time I'm in Fantasyland, am I even going to realize that there was planters that were there that are gone?
And the thing that's nice about Disneyland is, since it is always changing, for me, the things that change constantly, you know, even the small things that they're changing, I don't notice it as much because everything, it seems like, is changing. So you almost kind of expect it to be different each time you walk into the park.
I gotcha. That makes sense. Well, that wraps up our news segment today. So we've got still a lot of show to come. So this week, our discussion topic is going to talk about Dapper Days, which is a non-official Disneyland event, or a Disney event, actually, that happens in Paris, happens in Disney World, mm-hmm. and happens in Disneyland, or around Disneyland more specifically. We'll get into that. But Teresa was very happy to talk about this.
Yes, so I told Tag when we were when I was researching this earlier in the week, halfway through researching it, I just finally sent him a message. I said, okay, so the more I'm reading and the more I'm learning about this, because, I mean, I knew what Dapper Days was. I had a base knowledge, but the more I was just delving into it and seeing all the photos and looking at the culture and just the whole feel of it, I was just like, oh, can we please go? So I actually started looking at flight tickets to see how much it would cost to get out there. So, yeah. Anyway, so Dapper Days. So they actually have two different outings for the Disneyland Resort. There's one in the spring, one in the fall. So the spring outing date is actually coming up. It is on April 22nd. So what is Dapper Days? Dapper Days was actually started back in February of 2011 by LA designer Justin Jay. But it's just really, it's a really neat concept, and it's kind of more of a community, but it celebrates the old idea of stepping out in style and is basically designed for you to come out and show off your best. So this dates back to when Disneyland, the park, was first opened back in the 50s, when people would, when they would go visit the park, they would wear their quote-unquote Sunday best. And so it's kind of a nod back to that time.
Well, people used to do that all the time, and I don't know what happened to that, because, like, people would go, like, on airplanes, they'd wear all their nice stuff. Like, when they would go places, they would dress up, and I don't know how that kind of fell away as a society.
Yeah, I don't know either, because, I mean, even simple things like going to the grocery store, going to the bank, people would just dress up, you know, they just would dress up. I don't know why that changed, but this is kind of a nod back to that time. So the event does celebrate the refined styles, and they have various organized outings and social events that aren't limited to just Disneyland.
See, I didn't know that. I thought it was just a Disneyland thing, and I thought it was called Dapper Days, because, like, the Dapper Dance.
That's, you know, and that's what I was thinking too, but they actually also have events at museums, other theme parks, and, you know, various other places. But the Disneyland event includes bands, dancing. They have this great big expo that includes vintage and contemporary clothing, accessories, jewelry, beauty products, barbers, and just a whole lot more. They've got special guests that come in. I was reading they actually have some free swing dance classes, if that's your thing. Huh. All sorts of things to do. It just looks awesome. Plus, there's a lot of really great Dapper Days branded merchandise that you can purchase too.
You know, in all the times I've been to Disneyland, well, I guess I started in 2011, so that's why. I've only been to Disneyland twice since 2011, and I've never seen Dapper Days. I've always seen it online. I've seen pictures online. And a lot of people, like you said, you know, they go back to, like, the 50s kind of style, that vintage style, which I think is great. I mean, that's awesome. And there's actually a whole... you know, there's these kind of subcultures of people. So somebody I follow on Instagram that's a huge Disney fan also does. He's really into tiki stuff.
Oh, sure.
So, like, there's a whole subculture of people that are all about tiki stuff.
Yep.
You know, they wear the Hawaiian shirts and they do the bamboo and they do a lot of tiki stuff, and they love all that. And it's interesting to see that there's this whole group of people that are into, like, dressing up in style. And, like, I on their website, I remember reading there's a section on there that says that, you know, some people, you know, people do it just for the day, for this, you know, for whatever these events are. And some people just, that's how they live their life. They just dress up all nice all the time. Mm-hmm. Personally, I would love to dress up nice all the time. I love dressing up. However, I just don't, I haven't for a long time. I mean, I used to dress up all the time when I worked at the movie theater. I always tried to dress nice, and I'm not sure what happened to that with me. Maybe I should try to be a little more dapper more often.
So, one of the big questions, if you choose to attend Dapper Days, is what should I wear? So, although most of the attendees
wear clothes.
Yes, that is a good answer, clothes. But so, like we said, most of the people... choose to dress in a more vintage or mid-century style, dating back from the 1950s from when the park did first open. Dapper Days, the event, actually does not feature or focus on one specific time period, and they just are very open to all sophisticated attire. So it doesn't matter if it's modern, chic, or if it's vintage, classic. What, so, you know, just dress your best.
So I could go wearing a suit. Yeah, and that's appropriate.
Exactly.
Or a tuxedo, even. I wouldn't, exactly. But you could.
And then the other thing I thought was interesting too is they actually encourage that all active and retired military personnel can wear, if they want, their service uniforms or their dress blues to this event too.
That's really cool. I didn't know all of this about Dapper Days. I literally thought it was just vintage.
It's fascinating.
I thought it was like, what did I tell you that was the other thing that we could look at? It was the Bats Day.
Mm-hmm. I thought it was very similar. Another discussion topic down the road, yeah, I think.
But I thought that's how this was. I thought it was just dress up, period, and that was it. But this is very educational, yeah. Teresa.
So the expo, which is kind of, the more I was reading about this, I feel like the expo is kind of the main focus of this event. They do have the outing, which is where everybody, if you choose, you'd have to purchase park admission, but it's where everybody dresses their best on Sunday and goes into the park. But the expo is actually going to be held on April 21st and 22nd. It's at the Disneyland Hotel Exhibit Hall. Tickets are very reasonable. They're $10, which gets you in for both days. You can purchase your tickets at the door or online at dapperdays.com. Children 12 and under are also free, but this expo is 30,000 square feet of shopping and entertainment.
Wow.
And all of it is themed around the Dapper Days. So even if you decide to go on a whim, you could go to the expo and you could purchase an outfit on Saturday that you could then wear for Sunday. It's just awesome. The other cool thing that they offer is there's a free Dapper Day Expo shuttle that runs between the expo and the park with stops at the Disneyland Hotel and at the Grand Californian Hotel.
Wow. So they kind of cover everything.
Yeah. So park admission is not required for you if you want to just go to the expo. However, you will need to purchase park tickets if you would like to be part of the official Dapper Day outing, which is held in Disneyland. But there are special convention rate park passes and special hotel room rates that are available for this event. If you want more information on that, you can visit dapperday.com for more info.
That's really awesome. I just learned, you just schooled me on so much with this because, my conceptions were all wrong.
Yep. It's a really cool event.
Have any of you in the audience been to a Dapper Day or dressed up? I'm sure if you did, you've probably got pictures somewhere. Please send them along to us. Yeah, I would love to put them, to retweet them or share them on Facebook.
Or is anybody planning on going in a couple of weeks? The other thing that I think would be really fun to do, and I've seen various photos online of people doing this, is attending Dapper Days while Disney bounding. And if you don't know what Disney bounding is, so as adults, we are not allowed to wear actual costumes at the Disneyland Resort, but you can kind of, I guess, put a kind of a different spin on outfits. So, you know, just simple things like you can dress like Ariel by having red hair with, you know, a purple top and green bottoms. It's, you know, it's similar to what the character looked like, but it's not exact, so you can get away with it.
I've seen this. In fact, again, not the same person, but a different person I follow on Instagram. Him and his, I believe it's his girlfriend or it could be his wife.
Sure.
Go, and they go to Disney a lot.
Yeah.
And when they go, they like to Disney bound and dress like this, where one of the outfits I remember all the time from him is he will wear I believe it's yellow pants,
okay,
with a red jacket, a white shirt, and like a black bow tie, and he's supposed to look like Mickey Mouse.
Oh, sure.
And she dresses similarly. She'll wear like a polka dotty dress like Minnie Mouse.
Sure,
and she'll wear like little Minnie ears or whatever. She looks like Minnie. Now, you're not going to mistake her for a character, which is what I think Disneyland doesn't want,
right,
costumes. But you get the idea. You look at it and you go, oh, Minnie Mouse.
Yeah, it's very, Disney bounding the subculture with that. It's just I think it's very
interesting. We should do that when we go. Just one day.
The other thing that's cool with Disney bounding is you can recreate characters, but I've also seen it where people recreate rides and so rides in the attractions. Yeah. So
how do you do that?
Just look it up. There's also people are just amazingly creative with this stuff. It's really, really neat to look at.
Now you're gonna get me online looking at this stuff forever and ever. Oh, I get it. Like, okay, so I'm just looking at, I just went to Flickr and I did a search for Dapper Day Disneyland. And one of the pictures I have here is there's four guys dressed as like flying people that were in like the Condor Flats area of California Adventure. Yep. Mm-hmm. So I get that. Okay, that's pretty cool.
Yeah, it's neat.
Yeah, if you've done any of these things and you have pictures, please send them along to us. We don't have to share them on the show if you don't want, or we can share them on the show if you'd like. But I think it'd be interesting to see all this and kind of what the inspiration is and like how you came about that's what you wanted to Disney bound or to wear for Dapper Day. I think the whole thought process behind it's kind of cool, like because there's such a breadth of choices when you're thinking of Disney stuff. So you've got all the characters, you got all the attractions, you got all that stuff. So like how did you land on what you wanted to dress like and get that all together? Because some of the stuff that people wear, I've never seen anything like it in the stores or whatever. So do people make it?
You know, and a lot of these outfits I feel are just very, very detailed to the accessories, the jewelry, everything just goes together just seamlessly. They're just really, really awesomely well done
pieces. How have we not like looked or done anything about this before? Have you like studied this before, or is it just like this week?
This is the first time I've done like studied it in depth to get all the little tiny details of the expo prices and all that kind of stuff, but I've always known about the kind of, I guess, subculture behind it. Just because I just find it really cool and really interesting, and it's totally one of my things on my Disney bucket list, even though it's not technically a Disney sanctioned event. Totally one of my things that I have on my bucket list.
Now, I want to say Disney does not support a lot of different events. There are a lot of non-Disney events, but I will say in general, when they become things like this, Disney is not unsupportive of it.
No. It's just not an official Disney event. I mean, obviously they're supportive of it since the expo is held in the Disneyland Hotel, but it's just not an event that Disney puts on.
Super cool. Super cool. Well, thanks for doing all that information and figuring all that out.
Hopefully you guys learned something. Tag learned a couple of things.
I learned a lot. I didn't know anything about it, so now I feel edumacated. You came to the table with stuff like I had nothing about, so I'm impressed. Well, now let's get to some feedback. We have quite a bit of feedback this week, so let's start with some Patreon feedback. Our good friend Doug on Patreon said, in regards to the monorail wraps, he said, I would rather just have the monorail stay with the classic look. Don't really care for a skin on it. I'm sure there's some people that feel that way, and taking an attraction like that and putting, you know, some type of what could be looked at as like marketing on it, I can understand that, that people maybe don't have a good sense of that.
So our new friend Brandon, who did just become a patron, said, just started listening and I'm hooked. I'm a Disney junkie and love everything about this show. Great job, guys. Well, thank you, Brandon, for the really wonderful, awesome compliment. Sorry, I can't talk, apparently. And we're very excited that you're an avid listener and a fellow Disney junkie. I don't think there's enough of us out there.
There's plenty of us. It's just we don't talk about it, apparently.
There's never enough.
And Brandon, you are a cast member, so you are basically part of the show.
Yes, so thank you. Thank you again, Brandon. And again, like we mentioned before, he was out in the parks this weekend, so hopefully he had an amazing trip. The photos that he shared with us look like he had a great time. So, all right, so from Twitter, Nicole, I'm so excited that she gave us information on this. So to get the honorary citizen button, you have to take an oath and be sworn in. Well, I did anyway. Not sure if that's changed. Thank you, Nicole, because that is one of the first things that I'm doing when I step foot into the parks next is I need to get my hands on one of those buttons. Hopefully they still have them.
Yeah, I agree. Well, Diane said, excited to follow you. Love the podcast. Always an awesome time listening. Well, thank you, Diane. I appreciate all the feedback. I'm glad that you guys take the time to kind of you know, pass that along to us, even if it's just a simple love you guys.
Yeah. Steve, hey guys, I love the show, but your giant files are really tough for my phone to stream. Any chance you could knock down your bitrate? Maybe go mono. It would be a lot easier to stream. Just a suggestion. By the way, Guardians of the Galaxy Mission Breakout is pretty cool. So thank you for the feedback, Steve. I know Tag is definitely the tech guy.
Yep.
So Tag is trying to look at making maybe a smaller, different version for streaming to help with that. And thank you for your feedback on Guardians of the Galaxy Mission Breakout. I know Tag and I have been knocking it pretty much since we started this podcast. It's just because we really, really love Tower of Terror. But, you know, I'm kind of seeing it in a different light. And especially with all of the Marvel theming that's going to be happening over there, I'm definitely going to be on trying out that ride next time that we're there. And, you know, I have high hopes because the
people have said it's great.
Unfortunately, the only thing that I've been able to experience thus far is just videos. But this animatronic raccoon just looks
rocket
awesome. Just, yeah. So I'm excited. And just the fact that they're going to be changing out different things in the queue line, too.
Yeah.
Is really cool.
Again, that kind of goes like what we were talking about with the parade floats. It's nice that they changed just a little bit. So it makes you want to keep going in and over and over.
Yeah.
So Facebook was pretty active this week, and so Laura said, I knew about the inside counter of the Tiki Room, and I think people realized it as well, because last time I was there, I had to wait in a pretty decent line. So
Laura, stop giving out the secret.
The word is out. Well, we did it on the show, so I know. It looks like Brandon also said something.
Yeah, Brandon again. Love your show. I've been binge listening from the beginning, trying to get a head start on my next trip. He also commented, can't wait for this weekend. Anything you guys want pictures of while he's there. You know, and unfortunately, we did not request anything in particular, no. But he did share a lot of different cool things, tell us a lot about the things that he got to try at the Food and Wine Festival. So he's very informative. So again, thank you, Brandon.
Yes, thank you, Brandon. So this is where we got a little bit of controversy going on that we kind of wanted to talk about because this has come up a couple times. So I'm going to read Jessica's comment first, and then we'll kind of talk about it just a little bit. And then we have a rebuttal from Michelle, one of our listeners as well. So Jessica said, your irrational dislike of strollers tells me what I already knew. This is not a podcast for families. I like the news portion, but I can get that in plenty of other places. Unsubscribing for sure. Talk about... So we replied to this, and you know, I tried stating that, like, you know, I think that there are plenty of people that do need a stroller and, you know, that bring it to the park or whatever. But then there are also those people that I think just bring a stroller just to bring a stroller because it's easier for them when it's not really necessary, let's say. So she replied, you think they aren't needed. Unless you interview every single person, you have absolutely no way of knowing why they bought a stroller or what their kid needs it. Try to keep your judgment of others in check. So Jessica, I understand where you're coming from. We've gotten a lot of feedback between the survey and people with reviews and whatnot, talking about the fact that, you know, sometimes we don't come off as family friendly, or that we don't come off, you know, that we're kind of judgmental of that stuff. There's some more feedback later on about some attractions that we've talked about in the past that we kind of disparage, or people feel like we disparage. I'll be honest, there's really no attraction in Disneyland that I just completely dislike or hate. There are attractions that I think are a little overrated by some people. We'll get to that in another response that we have later on,
well,
too.
Everybody has their favorites.
Yeah, everybody has their favorites. You know, and if we come off that way, I'm sorry. We don't mean to come off that way. You know, a lot of our podcast is us just talking off the cuff about, you know, whatever our discussion is. So I think sometimes we don't realize what we say. Yeah. And sometimes we do realize what we say, and it's just our opinion.
Yep.
So why don't you read Michelle's review?
So Michelle responded back to Jessica, and Michelle said, I'm a mom who has a young child, and we brought a stroller on our last trip. I didn't take it personally, and we are doing whatever we can to not have a stroller this trip. They are annoying, even being someone pushing one. Getting hit on the ankles and people abusing it is a pain. Disneyland Weekly, I didn't take your statement as judgmental. It was just an opinion. So we did, you know, there were two different sides to this coin. And, you know, we do feel bad that some people took this more harshly than we intended for it to be. So I do feel bad that some people were quite offended by it, but that was, again, not our intent. I don't know if we've really discussed this on the podcast, but both Tag and I, we actually aren't parents. We don't have children of our own that we're taking to the parks. So we don't try to be anti-family on this show. We just, when we experience the park and we're talking about our experiences, it usually doesn't include children. So we just don't have...
that perspective.
Yeah, we don't have that perspective of going to the parks all the time and visiting with children. So it's just a different viewpoint of the parks. And, you know, obviously we're not going to be able to please everyone, even though that'd be great if we could.
Right.
But, you know, so we did feel bad about it. So again, we weren't trying to make, you know, hurt anyone's feelings. So,
and we do take everybody's comments on board. And so one thing that I think that is important is we do have some people that can be on the show that do have kids, that have gone with kids.
Yeah.
Or grandparents that have gone with kids. We do plan on having some folks like that on the show in the future. Obviously, some of our listeners who have become patrons that are in our chat have kids.
Yes.
And so, you know, with your perspective as listeners and commenting and sending us that information, we can have that as part of the show, even though if it's not directly from us, it's through our listeners. And I think that's just as valuable.
Yeah. Or, you know, we are in the works of having some guests on the show, which I know at least one of the guests has visited the park multiple times with his three children. So he definitely knows the ins and outs of going to the parks with kids.
Yeah, absolutely. So on iTunes this week, we got a review from Brian, who says, "My wife and I have been to Disney World in Orlando multiple times, including our honeymoon, but never Disneyland. We relocated from the East Coast to Seattle back in 2007 and have wanted to visit Disneyland ever since. After booking the trip back in the fall of last year, I began doing research. Your podcast was one of the best, most informative tools I found. I give you a lot of credit in our trip being so amazing. Your tips and information give me so many ways to be efficient and maximize our visit. There were five of us, three children between the ages of 5 and 9, and we did open to close 3 of the 4 days. It was awesome. We've since gone and come back from our trip during the Food and Wine Fest." Teresa, I'm sure is jealous. "And I still listen to your podcast every week for fun. Keep up the good work." Well, thank you, Brian. I'm glad that our tips and tricks and covering of the news and everything can make your trip efficient and maximize your visit. I'm glad that you gave us credit. You don't need to. You can look like a genius. But
you know, and I also want to point out, I am very impressed that you have three kids between 5 and 9 that went open to close 3 of the 4. Those are long days for little legs. So that's
totally,
that is super awesome. So they obviously are park lovers themselves too. So to the next generation.
Yes, absolutely.
That's awesome.
All right, so we got some great email feedback as well. This week we had some email from a couple different people, and one of them was extremely long, so that will be posted in our show notes. I will read part of it on here, but here's Brittany's, which almost didn't make the podcast, you know, in its full form, but I decided to leave most of it. So Brittany said, "Love the podcast. Enjoy the information that you give, always relevant to what is going on in the park. I'm glad that you mentioned the military discount when planning trips. They are huge. You can go for 3 to 4 days, 156 to 185, for not much more than a single day park hopper. And the military member can purchase up to 5 of the discount tickets for family. The other money-saving tip I would mention is, with the Target debit credit card, you can purchase Disney gift cards and get the 5% off of them. You could then use the gift cards for tickets and in the park. You could even use the $5 to $10 gift cards you earn at Target towards them. We're huge Disney nerds, and with living in Arizona, we're able to get to the park a couple times a year, and your podcast allows us to have some of the magic in between our visits. We were just there March 10th to the 15th for some of the Food and Wine Festival, our first time at the festival, and really, really enjoyed it. The food was wonderful, and my one complaint to the podcast is that I feel like sometimes you guys hate on the not-so-extreme attractions, maybe even underrated, that may even be geared towards the smaller children. For example, Autopia. We love that ride, even before my son, who is 7, came along. Now with my son, it's even more fun because he gets to drive us around and he about dies from laughter when he hits the rails. One of my other tips to people traveling the park would be to try and do a day with no rides if you have the time. Walt meant for the park to be immersive, and there is so much to do and see that is not rides. This is one of our favorite things to do, and I sometimes think people get so caught up in rides they forget to soak in the magic. Also, don't miss Cars Land when they turn on the neon at night. Every night they make a big to-do when they turn it on, just like the scene in the movie." Brittany, I think you sent some pics in the email, but for some reason they didn't come through. So maybe try sending those again or sending us a link or something like that. But yes, Autopia, we've been really hard on Autopia, so I apologize for that. I think we kind of already covered it a little bit. We'll try to be a little less judgmental about
stuff.
You
know, I'm sorry, I couldn't stifle my laughter, but the part how your son just has so much fun hitting the rails, I think that is so adorable.
Yeah.
That's so cute.
Whiplash.
I love your tip with going to the park and not doing, you know, having a day without any of the rides or attractions.
Oh, totally.
I think that's a really, really neat concept and neat idea. And I think I'm going to actually try and plan that in to my next trip. Maybe, depending on how long we get to be there, maybe it won't be a full day, but at least
like half a day or something.
Something, yeah. Spend some time devoted to just appreciating the park.
You know what a good day would be too, that I forget about, because I do this sometimes, and that is take a day or half a day just to do like the shows.
Yeah.
So like when Aladdin was there, go see Aladdin, or now Frozen's there, mm-hmm. go see Frozen, mm-hmm. go see Mickey and the Magical Map, see Fantasmic, see the fireworks. Like just plan a yeah. whole day of just the shows that you can go see. You know, you can go into Tomorrowland and you can watch the Jedi Training Academy. So there's mm-hmm. all these little shows that you can go watch and get a full day of entertainment out of. You can watch the Dapper Dance. You know, if you get there at opening, there's the Disneyland band that comes out. So there's all these little things that are not attractions.
Well, and some of these things, like catching the Dapper Dance or the Disneyland band, that sort of stuff, you know, it's not constant. So it's not like it's really on this, you know, time schedule that every hour on the hour, be at this place and you'll see them.
Right.
So it's really neat to kind of catch little glimpses of extra magic, really. We had one of our listeners sent us, actually, it was a video of the Disneyland band with, it was Mary Poppins.
Yeah.
And they were, somebody was singing Jolly Holiday and they were dancing in the street. It was awesome. I've never have I run across that in the parks. I have apparently really bad timing.
You're probably too busy waiting in line.
I'm probably too busy rushing around and waiting in lines. But yeah, so I think that's a great idea. All right, so from Marshall, hello, Tag and Teresa. First, let me say thank you for all of your hard work that you put into all of your podcasts. I'm sure that all the research that you put in the walk around Disneyland and Disney California Adventure took time away from your everyday life, but it helped to contribute to a more interesting and informative podcast. I stumbled across your pod while trying to find more news and up-to-date information for our upcoming trips to Disneyland. We are fortunate enough to have an annual pass, at least for this year, before our youngest turns 3 and is still free, so I am always on the lookout for new and interesting things to try and do while in the parks. Our last trip, we all got to ride in the Captain's Tower and steer the Mark Twain around the Rivers of America. The way you guys talk about the park shows your affinity for them and your desire to share that love with others. Thank you and keep up the great work. Well, thank you so much for taking your time and sending us that email, Marshall. I think that's really cool that you guys got to steer the Mark Twain. That is something that I haven't done. I don't know, Tag.
I haven't done it either.
Tag hasn't done that either. So that's super cool. Yeah, if you guys have pictures of you and the family in the Captain's Tower, we would love to see them.
Oh, yeah, or video from up there.
Yeah.
I think the view from up there must be awesome. All right, so Marshall continued his email. So that was just the first part of his email. The second mm-hmm. part of his email, he said, sorry about the length of this review. So that brings me to the subject of the email. On our last visit to Disneyland and California Adventure, we were lucky enough to partake in some of the food and wine festival. We didn't get a chance to try everything, but we did look into the offerings before we arrived so we could make the most of the time we had. I will go up the corridor from Carthay Circle towards Golden Zephyr. So he kind of, you know, makes this whole down the parade route. So the entirety of the review can be read on our website at DisneylandWeekly.com in the show notes for this episode. But the quick summary is the festival exclusive Kingdom Common beer was good, and the Verkasi salmon was perfection. He continues, thank you guys so much for taking the time to at least read this for your enjoyment. And I know it's super long, so it's probably too much to use in the podcast, which it was. That said, I love listening to you guys on my way to and from work. I would be happy to contribute anything else to the podcast with our returning trips to the park since we have been trying to go almost every month. My 2-year-old is counting the days until Dumbo reopens, but has since fallen in love with the Astro Orbiters, where we almost timed it perfectly with riding them while the fireworks show was going on our last night at Disneyland. I look forward to the next episode and hope you both have a great rest of your week. Marshall, P.S. The rose gold strawberry churros are a skip unless you really like artificial strawberry flavoring. Too sweet.
So if anybody has time to go on our website, I would very much recommend reading this review that Marshall put together. It is so amazing, so detailed. He goes into all
sorts of... He ate a lot.
Yeah. I mean, reading this, it was making my mouth water. It was really cool. And I really appreciate you, Marshall, for taking the time to write that all down for us to be able to go through. I apologize that it was too long for us to put on the podcast, but hopefully you're okay with us linking it to the website. If not, please let us know right away and we'll take it down. But I think a lot of people can get a lot of information from what you wrote, and it was so well done too. So thank you so much for that.
And if they read it before Friday, they might actually get some use out of it too.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, as we wrap up this week, we want to thank all of you for listening each and every week. Please don't forget to support the show if you can by going to DisneylandWeekly.com/support or by sharing Disneyland Weekly on social media or by word of mouth with other Disneyland fans that you know.
If you like what you're hearing and want to support this podcast, you can help us out by becoming a patron. Patrons get some nice perks, including access to a chat with us and fellow Disney Park fans and some Disneyland Weekly swag. Find out more at DisneylandWeekly.com/support. So again, thank you to our new patrons this week, Tim, Brandon, and Anthony. Thank you all for joining at the different levels that you came with. We are, again, still working on getting the final, getting a finalized logo before we are able to order our Disneyland's weekly swag. So I do apologize that there will be a little bit of delay to get that, but it is coming. Don't worry.
It is coming.
We're very really excited about it.
We are really excited about it. Teresa has multiple times a week been like, I found this thing. We could do these buttons and we could do these things and we could do that. So she's almost as excited as you guys probably are. So we love seeing reviews on iTunes. Plus, it helps get our ranking better so more people can find us and join the community. Please write a review so we can read it on the show and others can know what you think. If you want to join in the conversation, you can follow us on Facebook by searching for Disneyland Weekly, on Twitter at DLWeekly, or sending us an email at feedback@DisneylandWeekly.com. Feel free to email, Facebook, or tweet us any questions, feedback, or suggestions you may have about the show.
We will be back next week with more Disneyland news and information.
So until then, go out and enjoy the parks.
Ladies and gentlemen, Disneyland has now ended its normal operating day. We hope you've enjoyed your visit to the Magic Kingdom and that you'll be back with us again soon.